stand by. We're about to begin. Good day and welcome to the Azufa UFC 209 conference call. Today's conference is being recorded. At this time, I would like to turn the conference over to Paige Berger. Please go ahead, ma'am.
Welcome, everyone, to the UFC 209 media conference call. UFC 209 takes place Saturday, March 4th from T-Mobile Arena in Las Vegas. The event will air live on pay-per-view at 10 p.m. Eastern and 7 in the West. The prelims air on FS1 at 8 p.m. Eastern, and the early prelims will kick off on Fight Pass at 6:30 Eastern. On today's call, please welcome the main and co-main event stars of UFC 209, welterweight champion Tyron Woodley, number one ranked lightweight contender Khabib Nurmagomedov, number two contender Tony Ferguson, who will meet for the interim 155-pound world title, and we will be joined primarily by Stephen Thompson. We can now open the call up to questions.
Thank you. If you would like to ask a question, please press star followed by the digit one. If you are on a speakerphone, please make sure your mute function is turned off to allow your signal to reach our equipment. Once again, star one to ask a question. And our first question, we'll hear from Jeffrey Harris with Jack Encarnacio with Boston Herald.
Thanks, guys. Tyron, first question for you. Why would you say this rematch is happening?
Hello? I'm sorry about that. I was trying to send someone to voicemail. I was following. I think this rematch is happening because the last fight was a draw.
Any other reasons? Is that the only reason?
I mean, I can say what I think the reasons why the rematch is happening, but, you know, obviously the fight was a draw according to the judges, and it was fight of the night, the biggest card of UFC history, so everyone wants to see it again, and, you know, I'm ready to roll.
Forgive me, it sounds like you have other thoughts. I'm interested in your thoughts on why it's happening, if you could expound on that a little bit.
You know what? Not many people are interested in my thoughts. You know, they want me to say what should be said, so that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to say the filter version of it. I'm excited. I'm in great shape, man. I feel so much better than I did the first time I fought him. I thought during that fight, I put on a great performance. And even going into this fight, man, I'm so confident. I had the best sparring session of the entire camp today. I'm just, you know, I'm all positive right now, man. I can't wait to go in. Go out there and prove to the world that I'm the best welterweight in the history of our sport.
Very good. How important is it going to be for you to keep your back off the fence and fight?
One more time, sorry. You were kind of bleeding out.
Sorry. How important is it going to be for you to keep your back off of the fence in this fight?
I don't know if it was that important. I mean, I don't see any moments in the fight when he actually hurt me to the point where the referee starts making steps towards us like I was in any jeopardy of his finish. I think I just need to do a few things differently. Obviously, you know, I'm not going to elaborate and give you my entire game plan, but I'm prepared to go out there and be a better version of what I was the last time and actually spar up on some of the things I did really well in the last fight, do more of it. So I'm just excited, man. I'm a complete mixed martial artist. I have the power, I got the wrestling, I got the ground game, you know, I got the endurance, and I got the mental toughness to go out here and put anybody away. So I'm just excited to go out there and have one more opportunity to prove I'm the greatest welterweight of all time.
And now with the announcement that GSP has come to terms again with the UFC, do you feel like you're helpless in campaigning for that fight, or do you feel like there's anything you can do on March 5th or on the mic that could improve your chances of getting GSP?
I'm not worried about GSP right now, man. I don't have time to go back and forth on that roller coaster ride. I got a wonder boy who is a guy that's getting a second opportunity. He's in a win-win situation. And I'm just going out there to do my thing, man. That's all I can focus on right now. So going out there and thinking about George and coming up short, I'm in my position with any possibility of fighting those guys. So I just don't want to focus on any of that right now.
All right, thanks. This question for Stephen. Stephen, why do you think this rematch is happening?
I don't even think Stephen's on the line.
Stephen is not on the line.
Apologies. Okay, that'll do it for me. Thank you.
And next we'll move to Jeffrey Harris with 411 Mania MMA.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. First question for Tyron. Are you concerned at all about any adjustments Stephen might make this time, or does your performance in the last fight make you think you'll be well prepared for any adjustments and changes he might make this time around?
And I'm not concerned about anything. I mean, what did he do to me in that last fight that should make me concerned? Like, be honest. Like, I'm not the one that got knocked down four times in one round, nearly submitted, completely dominated in the first round. I'm going to make an adjustment because I'm a martial artist and I'm a perfectionist and I'm a, you know, a hard worker. But there's nothing he did in the fight and there's nothing he could have done in a training camp that's going to make him that much different of a fighter. So with that said, no, I'm not concerned. I don't take it for granted. I don't take any opponent lightly. And that's why when I went out and fought him the first time, he didn't surprise me with anything that he did. I expected him to do that. Actually expected him to do a little bit more.
Thank you, Tyron. And for Tony, how exciting is it for you? You're in a five-round UFC title fight. I think this is one of the greatest lightweight matchups of all time. What do you think of the matchup? And what is your overall mindset and feeling to be on the verge of this fight right now? It's a fantastic fight.
Well, for myself, this is another fight. This is nothing different. There's no other difference besides he's another name on that wrestling chart, man. I've always looked at it that way, and I'm never going to stop, no matter how much clout and how much people feed it up to be and how big of a head everybody else has. I'm going to keep doing the same thing, which is being me and letting myself flow inside that octagon. And nobody's going to stop me, man, on my way to victory.
If for Khabib Nurmagomedov, Phil, you're finally in a UFC title fight. You've been through a lot. You had a two-year layoff, and now you're back. And, you've been winning fights spectacularly, and you're finally in a UFC title opportunity. So after everything you've been through, what's it like to be in this situation?
Hello?
For Khabib?
I don't hear you guys.
So I was asking, what's it like after everything you've been through after your layoff, being a UFC title opportunity, which you've been coveting and you've been going after for quite some time?
You know, I am very excited about this fight because this is what I want all my life. And, you know, March 4, my dream has come true. And, you know, I have very big fight and a very big UFC fight card. And, you know, like Peter Rusho, I'm very excited about this. I just finished my last hard sparring. I'm healthy, no injuries, no nothing. I am best shape of all time, my career, and now make weight, and March 4, I'm going to make history. I'm going to break this guy. This thing is tough, but when cage closed and me and him alone inside the cage, I'm going to break this guy.
You ain't breaking shit.
He don't understand how I'm strong. He don't understand it. All the time when he fight with Western guys, he have problem, but he never fight
he
with,
lost
with
because
Western guys. You never fight with a wrestling guy like I have, you know, like I have power. I have.
You lost to T-Bow, dude, straight up. You lost to T-Bow in that first entrance fight, man. Your first fight, you lost to him. I beat him in the first round. How can you say that you lost? Man, you lost that fight, fair and square. I saw that.
Hey, this is, you know, like my.
You ain't breaking shit, dude. You keep talking.
Okay. But you lost for Michael Johnson. Michael Johnson kicked your ass.
No, he didn't kick my ass. He broke my arm, and I fought the rest of the fight. I fought the rest of the fight, and I smacked him with that arm.
Hey, you talk about Michael Johnson going to kill me. What happened?
Well, you think I'm going to root for you? Fuck no, I ain't going to root for you.
No. You talk about, hey, Michael Johnson going to kill him. What happened? I finish him. I can finish him first round. I can finish him second round. You know, I just talked
with Michael Johnson,
and,
dude. That's a whole completely different person, dude. I would destroy Michael Johnson now.
You go
ain't
down.
Kicking shit, dude.
You seven times you have seven times knocked down. You go down seven times. You go down. What
hey,
happened?
Dude, you try to take me down, you're gonna find out exactly how sharp my elbows are.
Okay. We'll see what happens. March 4. We have 1 week. 1 week. After 1 week, everybody see who is who.
Yeah. After 1 week, you're not gonna have your team to back you up. Nobody else is going to be inside
that octagon with you. Inside the cage, I'm going to block you.
You ain't going to break shit. Only thing you're going to break is your heart after I kick your ass.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah, just try to make weight, dude.
My weight is great. My weight is great. Don't worry about me. Shut up and train.
Nah, dude, my training is good, man. You have no idea how hard I train. I'm on a whole new level
other
than
you,
man.
Why you talk about my training? Why you talk about my weight? Why you talk about my condition?
Because you're fat, dude. You're fat. You'll never make weight, and your conditioning sucks.
Okay, see you. See you Friday. See you. I show you my weight.
Listen.
I show you my weight Friday, and I show you my spirit in Saturday.
Yeah, go ahead, man. I'm going to break your spirit.
Okay, let's go. Let's see what happens.
Okay, guys, we've now got Steven Thompson on the line, so let's go ahead to Damon Martin with Fox Sports.
Hey, guys, first question for Tony. I know you've probably answered this question a million times, but how do you feel like your wrestling matches up with Khabib's wrestling, just in a pure wrestling aspect?
From pure wrestling? I got 20-plus years. I got 20-plus years doing this sport, man. And I did so well in it, I actually took up other sports because of it. I got bored with wrestling because, you know, it was so awesome, and I loved it, and I did it for so long, I want to learn how to box. This guy has no chance against my wrestling, dude. He thinks Sambo is awesome. I got respect for the sport. I got respect for where he comes from. But my wrestling is far superior, and my style is just completely different than his. My freestyle background is going to put – I'm gonna run circles all over this guy.
Hey, I have one question. Okay, if you're so confident like this, why you try running away from this fight? Why? I make this fight. You know,
there's nobody running away from this fight. There's nobody fucking running from you. Absolutely not. I'm staring at you right in the eyes. You, dude, you're a punk. You're a fucking bully. You're a fucking bully, just like everybody else at AKA. All you guys do is talk shit.
You
go ahead. Wait till March 4th.
Okay.
Wait, just wait.
Why you try running away from this fight? Why?
Nobody is running from it. Hey, dude, nobody's running. The only person that's fucking running is fucking Connor, dude. Absolutely not.
Okay.
Nobody's running from
that. No. Calm down. I want to ask
you. Dana was the only one that separated me from beating your ass over at that conference.
No. Listen. You talk too much. I want to ask you something, please. Wait.
No. You and your fans talk too much. I see how you are. You're a bully, dude. I'm going to kick your ass, Khabib.
Hey, why you talk too much? Give me. I want to ask you something. Listen. Why you try running away from this fight? Or give me this.
Who tried running away from this fight? Hey, dude.
No. I can fight with him. I can fight with him. Nothing. No, I don't need money. I just want to fight.
Nobody is running from you, G. Nobody is running from you. You can go ahead and have your manager try to tell you all the things to say, but honestly, I don't give two fucks. Nobody is running from you. I'm standing right in front of you.
About money. I
don't give two fucks.
What I want to break your faith. I want to break your heart. This is what I want. You have to stay ready, Marco.
No, try to do it. You say you want to break my arm? You say you're going to try to break my arm? No, Khabib, I got a message for you. You say you're going
to
try to break my arm?
I
love holding my baby. So I'm going
to
say, go ahead, I dare you.
I bring you here. I bring you. Nobody bring you. I bring you.
You didn't do shit, dude. Your padded record ain't nothing. You know what? You got two round fucking victories, which are absolutely nothing, man.
Okay, you're tough, guys. No, listen. UFC,
no, nobody's listening to you. I can't even understand you, dude. Your hat is covering your ears. You're not listening to me.
I can
your
take
hat for a mop.
And make money. But I say, hey, I don't need money. I don't need nothing. Please give me this guy because I'm going to break your face. I'm going to break it.
Nobody's breaking
but
shit.
Try to run. I make this fight. Not Dana, not UFC. Nobody make this fight.
You didn't make shit, dude. You're going to fight another Nate Orchard? Is that what you're going to fight? Another Nate Orchard and bully him? Come on, man.
Because I bring you here.
Nobody brought. Yeah, right. Okay, so all the nine victories that I have, right? Nine victories that I have in a row. Man, you're going
to
be like, okay, yeah, I did that. Tony, I did that. I did all the work, man. You didn't do shit. Fuck you, Khabib. You didn't do nothing, dude. You're a bully, dude. I'm the fucking matador. I'm going to finish your ass. You got shit against me, dude. You can keep talking, bro. You talk way too much. You say I fuck? You
talk
way too much. You talk way too much. You're a fucking bully. And I'm going to put you away.
Okay, guys, one more question. Let Damon ask his next question.
Tony, when you look at the guys you've beaten on the 9-fight win streak, you've obviously beaten some great fighters, including the former champ, Rafael Dos Anjos. But where do you rank Khabib? Do you believe he is the toughest opponent you faced?
Yeah, he's the next in line, man. Nothing, you know what? Doubt never got me here, and nobody else held my hand to get me here. my fucking hard work, my determination, and my finishing people and earning my performance victories has gotten me here. Dude, I'm going to finish this dude like I did everybody else. I'm not going to even tell you how. I'm not like anybody else. This guy wants to talk about trying to break me, break my arm, break this, and he says I talk too much. Dude, I ain't fucking said nothing. Dude, I just hyped up the fight. You got 1.9 million people that are going to be fucking sad as fuck when I go in there and I finish your ass.
No, okay, I want to say something. Please listen. When UFC asked me, hey, you have to fight with Tony, I said, okay, let's go. This is what I want because we have 9 win streak, I have 8 win streak. We have to fight. And after UFC asked him, he said, please give me money, give me this. He tried to run. But I said,
oh, there's no fucking please, nothing, dude. It's what I've earned. You know, you can talk as much shit. Like I said, your management speaks for you, man. And you know what? I don't give two fucks.
You
go ahead. Try to hype it up.
I talk to you now. You have to shut up. Focus on myself. Listen to me.
Bullshit, dude. You were trying to fucking pay me. I said, you know what? I spit on your money, dude. Your money is fucking worthless to me. I can give two fucks. I want a UFC's money because I earned it.
You're talking about you asked about money. I said, okay, I'll give you money.
I didn't ask you for shit. Nobody asked you for absolutely nothing. Now you're fucking full of shit. You're full of shit. You're full of shit. I never asked you for nothing. Only thing I asked for is your face so I can smack it.
No, UFC said he doesn't want to fight with you because he needs money. I said, okay, I give you money. Don't worry. I have money. I give you money. Please take this guy.
How about that, dude? You know what? It's not about the money. It's about being fair. How about that? It's about being fair. A fair fight. That's what it's about.
I can fight with others. Easy fight. I can take this fight. But I said, please, I need tough fight. You know why?
You're about to fight Jose Aldo. You're about to pick on a 145.
Because
so I don't
my
know what the fuck you're talking about.
In your head, you know, that's why I asked. But you never ask about fight with me. You never ask. You try to run away from
me.
Dude,
you were next in line no matter what.
Please give me money. You know why you ask too much money? Because you know you have this. This is your last fight.
You beat. What ranking was Michael Johnson? What ranking was Michael Johnson?
This is your last fight in the UFC. That's why. You're beginning to
cry. Absolutely not.
We'll see March 4. I'm going to break your career. I'm going to break your face.
Khabib, you have 1.9 million followers that are going to be fucking absolutely detrified when I go in there and I finish your ass and see your ass all fucking bloody.
You have to beat my feet because I bring you here. I make this fight. You have to beat
I'm going
to
throw
feet.
You. I'm going to throw you from your head to your toes, dude. I'm going to flip you upside down and everybody inside the octagon is going to see it, dude. And nobody's going to be able to save your ass besides John McCarthy or Herb Dean. I don't give two fucks, whatever you fucking say.
And for interruption, Damon Martin has another question.
You know why you're nervous? Because I told you I said true. That's why you're nervous. If I say talking, you never nervous. Because I say true. I make this fight. You try to run away from
you didn't make shit, dude. You act like you have so much clout. You didn't make shit, dude. You know what? You're just the next person in line for me, man. So you know what? You could either step aside and fucking miss this ass beating, or you can step inside that octagon and come at UFC 209 at the T-Mobile Arena, and you're going to get your ass kicked by myself. You're going to really find out what fucking El Kukui. It means fucking Baba Yaga, bro.
El Kukui, El Kuk, El Nagda. You're not El Kukui, you El Nagda.
Baba Yaga.
7 times you go down in UFC.
All my life,
you El Nagda. El Nagda. You're not El Kukui. You understand? You have to shut up.
No, it's Baba Yaga.
I'm going to finish your career.
You ain't got shit, dude. Try it.
Okay, we'll see. See you. El Nagdown.
Hey, whatever you say, Khabib, it ain't going to save you.
And one question for Wonderboy. Sorry to interrupt that. One question for Wonderboy. Steven, you know, obviously the last fight, it was a draw on the scorecards, but, I mean, listen, we can't deny the damage that Tyron did, especially in that first and the fourth round. So what is the biggest difference in this fight? How can you prevent those kind of moments from happening again and kind of take advantage and kind of put a, you know, an exclamation point, so to speak, to make sure you get a win this time?
Well, you know, not being lazy on my strikes. First round, throwing lazy kick, got caught, ended up getting taken down. Tyron's a very strong opponent, very strong grappler. Could definitely feel that on top. Obviously, you know, as you saw in that first round. So just being ready at every point, every step of the way during all five rounds, if it even goes that, throwing my kicks and just making sure I'm back in position. The first round, I ended up throwing that lazy kick, like I said, and didn't get him back like I was supposed to, and he ended up catching the kick. So. Just being on point every step of the way, and being mindful of his power. I mean, he's a powerful guy. He's knocked dudes out. I mean, he saw what he did to Robbie. So, and he smoked me in the head in the fourth round. So, you just gotta be on point, man. Gotta hit and move, baby.
And, you know, everyone applauds you for your creativity, so to speak, when you're in the cage. You did it against Johnny Hendricks. You showed that off against Jake Ellenberger. But you didn't quite show that in the first fight. Not saying you have to throw spin kicks, but you know what I mean. So showing that creativity in your striking. Did you notice that when you went back and rewatched the fight? And do you feel like you'll be more comfortable in the rematch to throw those kind of things, that creativity you've shown in so many of your fights?
Yeah, you know, I mean, that's how I normally fight. My last fight, I was very hesitant, like I said before. So just got to go out there and, like I said, fight like I normally do. Just let it all out, you know. Don't hold anything back.
Awesome. Thanks.
Hey, Damon, I got a question
yes, sir.
For you, brother. Why are you trying to get me in trouble in the doghouse, man, with that headline?
Read the article. The article's good.
On,
the article.
I read the article. The article was okay. The headline made it seem like I was about to try to go at Dana White's throat.
You got to read the article. That's the point. You got to read
I
the
know.
Article.
You're trying to get people all pumped up so they can think I was saying some crazy stuff in there. No, I'm just giving you crap, man.
Thanks, guys.
And next, we'll move to Stephen Meraki with MMAJunkie.com.
Stephen Meraki. Tony, I wanted to follow up on something you said about Khabib's 1.9 million, the 1.9 million people that would be disappointed. We talked to Nick Lentz a while ago, and he said that that fan base kind of follows him wherever he goes online and kind of gangs up on the people that he's fighting or his team is fighting. And I'm wondering if the same thing's happened to you.
Well, I mean, it is what it is. I had to deal with this asshole about 3 times already. And that's humbly speaking, but you know what? Honestly, shit happens. But, you know, I got nothing but respect for anybody that loves the sport of mixed martial arts. But they're going to be really sad come that day, man, when I have my hand raised in victory.
So have you had to deal with people, you know?
Oh, I don't give 2 shits. Maybe in the first part. Now I don't give 2 fucks, honestly, and I just don't. I'm too busy. I post and I forget. I don't really give any. Honestly, I don't care. I don't care. My wife and I, we actually laugh about it. We're like, man, this guy's actually kind of cool. I bet you Google Translate like going crazy and their stock is flying through the roof. But you know, I have no hate on it. It is what it is, and it's the game. It's part of the game. But if you can't handle it, get the fuck out of the kitchen.
All right. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And next, we'll move to Kendrick Johnson with RingTV.com.
My question is for Tony. How are you doing, Tony?
Good. How are you?
It seems like he legitimately got your heat. Is he getting on your skin, or is it just that you're about that life when it comes to the game of martial arts?
Say that question again.
I said, is he under your skin, or is it just the fact that you're just intense and you're about that life when it comes to the game of mixed martial arts?
This dude's trying to take food off my table, bro. He's talking shit, so of course, man. Of course I'm going to get heated. This is a fight. This isn't checkers. This isn't a regular game. This ain't Connect Four. We're out there slinging leather, man. This dude's going to get cut. Straight up. I don't have to talk too much shit.
I think it is if you were able to be with the guy that first guy to put a loss on his record and stop him. I think it deal with that being a feather in your cap.
I can barely hear you. What did you say?
I said, how big of a feather the cap would be to not only get a loss, but to get stop him. I can tell you're obsessed with stopping him. So if you were to make your goal a reality, how big of a feather in your cap would that be?
Well, look, man. If somebody doesn't piss me off, I'll finish him in the first round. This dude pissed me off. I'm going to drag him into deep waters if he's dealing with a hammerhead. I don't have to talk too much about it, man. I already talked to him about it. You guys are going to see fucking fireworks. This should be the main event. I don't know why Stephen Thompson and Pete Woodley are the main event. But this shit everybody's talking about. This is the third time. Third time's a charm.
Because I'm a world champion.
I'm going to come after him hard. I'm going to come after him hard. I played multiple sports growing up, man. I'm a 2-time All-American, 3-time All-State, State champ, National champ. This dude is not on my level. He is not on my level. As hard as I fucking work and I do what I represent from where my talent, in my state, from California to Michigan, in between and all around the world, nobody's going to take this away from me. I love holding my baby boy, and this dude says he wants to try to break my arm. I said, go ahead and try to bring that shit. You break it, I got other parts of my body I'm going to hit you with, motherfucker. So, you better be ready.
Hey, you nervous about your arm?
Thanks, and my next question is for Steven. Steven, is there any way that you can win the fight if the fight goes to the ground, or is there any adjustments that you saw that you have to make to make things differently?
Yeah, man. You know, in the last fight, I was definitely got caught on the bottom. Tyron's got a good top game, and he's very strong on top. I do have a ground game. I just couldn't. I wasn't able to implement it. He was just very strong on top. I was walking around very light, and I could definitely feel that in those clinch positions. So working on my weight, feeling stronger now. My ground game is getting better every day. And yeah, man, we're working, baby. We're working. This is the top of the game. I'm fighting the best of the best. So. Game is getting better every day.
And how big a deal was it to be an MSG and fight them in that environment and be on that big stage? Is that something that you needed? Because that was kind of like the biggest stage of your career so far. Then. Is that what you needed to get used to being on this big stage?
Yeah, man. You know what? It was huge for me being at UFC 205, fighting Tyron. Definitely a dream come true, man. And you know, I love it. That's why we're in the game, man. We're here to fight the best of the best. In front of the world, so that was definitely the biggest stage in my career. So we're going to be doing it again March 4th at T-Mobile Arena, and we're going to be throwing down.
And final question, do you think the pressure's on you to take the fight to him, or do you just have to sit back and kind of do what you like you've done? Do you think the pressure's on you to make the adjustments since this is the first rematch of your career?
Who was that to?
Was that for me or Steven?
Steven. Well,
oh, say that. Oh, okay, sorry. Say that again?
Steve, this comes for both of y'all. Who thinks they need to make the most adjustments? Do you think the pressure's on you, Steven, since the perception is that you got dropped in the first and the fourth round? The pressure's on you to make adjustments?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, Tyron's an intelligent guy. You know he's going to be making some adjustments. We're both going to be making adjustments, man, to make this fight exciting and try and leave with that W. So I know he's making adjustments. I'm making adjustments, which is going to make this fight even better.
As a final question, Tyron, did you just do what you did and keep doing what you've been doing?
You know, the goal is to always evolve, always get better. You know, even in wrestling, you know, I had some chance to work with my teammate Ben Askren, get better in wrestling, get better on the ground. And my coach Dean Thomas. So, no, you'll never see the same Tyron walking the octagon. I'm always scoring, always getting better as a fighter.
Thank y'all. Let's go see y'all next week.
And next we'll move to Heidi Fang with Las Vegas Review-Journal.
Hi. My first question is for Tony Ferguson. You've been talking a lot about Conor McGregor running. If you were to get past Khabib Nurmagomedov, then when would you hope to face possibly McGregor and unify the title? I mean, do you think that's something that would happen next?
Conor McGregor, obviously, he's in my weight class, and he's trying to avoid me by going over to boxing and whatever. I honestly can care less. This is a man's sport that we play. I've been boxing for a long time. I've been with the greatest boxers, been trained by them over in the 805. Robert Garcia was one of my first coaches, Joseph Janik, Victor Ortiz's coach. Now I'm working with Rashad Holloway from Wildcard Boxing. I've been putting in my work and putting in my effort, man. And Khabib and me, we're going to have this war. And whatever Conor does, man, I gave him a pass. I don't have to talk too much shit. He's got his kid coming up. I told him, go spend some of that money, dude. Go do what you got to do and earn that little thing that you got and then come back when you're ready to be a man. And, you know, this is a sport. I'm at 155. Once I'm done with this one, I'll move on and I'll make sure whoever's next, man, is going to get it. But right now, the fight at hand is Khabib Nurmagomedov for UFC 209 for the interim title. And we're here to do business. You fans are in for a treat. I don't even think you guys know exactly what's going to happen. So much heat is going to be pressed on this, especially when I'm on my way to victory. You have no idea what this is going to bring for the fans. They've been waiting for this fight for three times. This is the third time that everybody's been waiting for this fight. Everybody just wants to see it done. I just want to see it done myself. I'm sure Khabib will probably agree with me that he just wants to get this shit over with.
Mm-hmm. Khabib, do you have any response to that?
What did you say?
I was wondering if you had any response to what Tony said about hoping just to get this over with after the anticipation and build-up of having this fight scheduled three times.
Yes, the first time I have injured. Second time he has injured. Yes, a lot of people waiting for this fight, you know. And I am number one, he's number two. You know, this is real. high level. You know, I think, my opinion, this is great, greatest matchup in lightweight history in UFC, you know. And he's a tough guy. I'm not easy guy, you know. And March 4th, we'll see what happens. But I told you guys a lot of time what I'm going to do. And we'll see what happens. I don't want to talk too much, you know, about this fight. Everybody knows I make this fight. And Tony knows.
He didn't make shit.
I make this fight. I make this fight.
He didn't make shit. He didn't make shit.
Because he tried to run away. But I say, it's okay.
I've never ran from nobody, buddy.
But I ask you about money. Why you don't take money? I ask you about $200,000. This is big money in USA.
I don't want your money. I want the UFC's money. I'd do the same thing, bro, if you were in my fucking shorts. I would. I'd be like, you know what, here's $200,000. Go for it, dude.
You know why?
I don't need the money, dude. Who fucking needs the money? Nobody needs the money. I want to beat your ass. That's all I want to do.
That's why you're going to lose yourself. That's why you don't take this money. Because you beginning cry with USA. I need money because
I don't want you fake ass money, dude. You know what? You keep that money, you wipe your ass with it, do whatever the fuck you want with it. I don't give
a
fuck, man. Why don't you donate it? Why don't you be a man and donate that?
You understand. No, calm down. Relax.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you understand. You understand who is who and what happened after this fight. Because
you say you're number one, but you're number one bullshit. Your padded ass record ain't nothing.
Hey, what are you talking about? Why you ask about money? We fight. We're supposed to fight before 2 times. I say, hey, I have to fight with him. Let's go. Give me this guy. I can fight with him free. I don't care about money. Give me this guy. And after UFC called me, my manager, I say,
it's because you got too many people talking in your ear, and that's your problem. That's why I'm going to win. That's it. Your focus is around so much other bullshit, dude. You're talking about breaking arms and talking about fighting Conor and doing this and that and all this other stuff. Dude, I hear you. I understand it, man. You're going to lose. You got to look out for yourself.
Go ahead. I don't think about Conor. I think about you. I think I'm going to break you. This is what I think. I don't think about Conor, other stuff. What are you talking about? You talk about Conor. I never.
Dude, I am unbreakable.
I talk about
him. I am unbreakable.
This guy chicken. You unbreakable? We'll see March 4th.
Yeah, trust me, dude. I'm fucking a machine now. You have no idea what you're dealing with. You just woke me up.
You're just funny guy. You're not my shame.
You keep laughing. I'm the new John Wick.
Hey, how many times you lose? Danny Castillo beat your ass. You remember this?
Danny Castillo didn't do shit. Danny laid on me, dude. I beat his ass,
Michael
too.
Johnson.
Trust me. The only thing he could do was hold on for dear life. That was it. Dude, you almost lost
to how many times you lose?
Hey, you lost to Tebow. I'm sorry, but you lost to Tebow. Sorry,
not
sorry.
Hey,
you remember that fight? Look, I'll post it up today. I will post it up today, and I seen you losing that Sambo fight, that Sambo match where you were fucking crying on your knees because you won or you lost.
Which Sambo fight? When I'm 17 years old, of course I lose a lot of time when I have competition in amateur, but professional career.
Everything's been handed to you. Nothing's been handed to me. Nothing has been handed to me. I've earned every single step of the way.
You're just funny, guys.
Nothing has been handed to me. And Gal for sure never got me here, motherfucker. Straight up.
Okay, let's go to our final question from Spencer Kite with UFC.com.
The question for Tyron. Obviously, reaching this point of being the UFC champion has been the goal for a long time. But there were some hurdles. There were some starts and stops. What has it been in the last couple of years that has allowed you to get to this point and reach that full potential that you always believed you had?
Just resilience, man. My goal has been the same since I started the sport. Mixed martial art is too tough of a sport not to want to be a champion in it. So I just didn't allow any, you know, hurdles, stumbling blocks, any, you know, losses or anything that came along the way to stop me from trying to do it. So just had my mind set on being a champion, went out there and did what I needed to do, and now my goals have shifted. I want to be the best welterweight ever. And there's a few guys on the list, including, you know, finishing up this business with Wonder Boy, that's going to cement that for me.
You mentioned a couple times now being the best welterweight in history. Who else is on that list? What does that entail for you?
I mean, obviously, Damian Maia, Gerard St. Pierre, Nick Diaz. those are guys that, you know, obviously are on that list. But, you know, I've done a great job of, you know, not talking about the George St. Pierre, not talking about the other guys. You know, Stephen's a tough enough opponent that he deserves that respect. If I look too far ahead, I'm going to come up, you know, with an L on March 4th, and then he'll be fighting those fights. So my manager called me and was like, hey, you hear about Drew? I said, man, don't call me with that BS, man. I got somebody that wanted to take my belt on March 4th, and that's all I'm focusing on. I haven't read one article. I don't know what the entire hoopla is about. I've been focused on this fight, man, and I just feel so awesome. This is the best I've felt in a very long time. I'm just excited to get in there and get after it.
Appreciate it.
And at this time, I would like to turn the call back over to Paige Berger for any additional or closing remarks.
Thanks, guys. We'd like to thank everybody for joining us on today's call. UFC 209 activities kick off Wednesday with open workouts at T-Mobile Arena, followed by Ultimate Media Day Thursday, also at T-Mobile Arena. Updated schedule of events for Fight Week is available on the UFC press portal. Have a great day, everyone, and we'll see you next week in Vegas.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And that will conclude today's call. We thank you for your participation.